This is Coding Math, episode 13, Friction. Still continuing our series on basic physics for programmers, today we're going to cover the theory behind friction and a couple of different ways to implement it. One way will be generally correct from a physics viewpoint, though very simplified. The other, totally wrong. But I'll argue that it's good enough for most applications. So what is friction, and what do you already know about it? First of all, there's a bunch of different types of friction. Dry friction, fluid friction, lubricated friction, skin friction, and internal friction. No, I'm not making these up. You can look all of these up to learn more about them, but in this video we're mainly talking about dry friction, which is when two surfaces are in contact, and skin friction, which is the friction that occurs when an object moves through a liquid or some other medium, like the atmosphere. Skin friction is also part of what we call drag. Okay, well, we know that if you're moving along at a certain speed and encounter some friction, it will slow you down. In other words, it will change your speed. And we know that speed is one component of velocity, so friction is something that changes velocity. Well, hey, that's the definition of acceleration. So yes, friction is a force vector that we can use just like an acceleration vector. Now, of course, in reality, friction can be very complex and depend on a large number of factors. The materials of the two surfaces, or the materials of the object and the medium it's moving through, the surface area, the shape, the weight, the slope of the surface, the temperature, turbulence in the medium, etc., etc. So for our purposes, we're going to simplify all that down into a single vector whose direction is exactly opposite the velocity of the object it's acting on. So, if this object is moving with a velocity like this, the friction vector will be a vector like this. If you add those vectors, you'll get a new velocity vector with the same direction, but a somewhat smaller magnitude. In other words, friction slowed the object down. If the object were moving in this direction, the friction would be a vector like this, and so on. Now, it may seem strange to imagine friction as a force that is actively pushing something in a direction. We tend to think of it as more of a passive resistance. But Newton's third law says that for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. So, when an object is moving through a medium such as air, it's pushing on those air molecules, and they're pushing back on the object. The same for an object moving across a surface. Okay, so we have a friction vector, and we know its direction, but what about its magnitude? Well, as I just said, there are many complex factors that go into determining friction. Feel free to research this all on your own, but for most games or non-scientific simulations, you're not going to sit down and try to figure out all those factors into a final magnitude. You're more likely going to come up with a number through trial and error. A number that makes the animation look right. I'm also going to say that for the sake of the kinds of simulations we'll be doing, that an object's velocity will have no effect on the amount of friction being applied. In other words, for a given object in a given environment, the friction will be the same, whether that object is moving fast or slow. This is essentially true, but it's a major simplification. In the real world, varying speeds can have all kinds of secondary effects that could alter the force of friction. There's one other interesting fact about friction as compared to other acceleration vectors. If I throw a ball up into the air, it will have a velocity like this, straight up. Gravity will be a vector in the opposite direction, reducing its speed. Eventually, that ball's velocity will reach zero. It will stop, and then gravity will pull it back down in the opposite direction. But friction will never reverse the direction of an object. If I slide an object across the surface, it will have a velocity like this, and friction will be a vector in the opposite direction. It will reduce the object's velocity until it hits zero, and then it's game over. At some point, the object's velocity vector may be smaller than the friction vector, and if you just added them together, you would get a reversed velocity. So you have to be careful to make sure that reversal never happens in your code. Okay, so how do we apply this to code? I've set up a sample project with a file called friction1.js. It creates a particle at center screen, with a velocity of 10 pixels per frame in a random direction. We can run this a few times to see how it looks. Now back in the code, we can create a friction vector. I'll give it an x of 0.15 and a y of 0. This incidentally gives the vector a length of 0.15 and an angle of 0. As I've just described, the length will never change, but the angle may. The 0.15 value is just one that I got through trial and error, as I mentioned earlier. I chose it because it causes the particle to slow down and stop before it goes off screen. Now in each frame, we need to determine the angle of this friction vector and add it to the particle's velocity. There are a number of ways we can do this. We can take the angle of the velocity vector, which looks like this, and add 180 degrees, or pi radians, to it to get the angle for the friction vector, then add the friction to the velocity. Or we could set the friction angle to be the same as the velocity angle and subtract the two vectors rather than adding them. Or, instead of giving the friction a positive length of 0.15, we could reverse it with a length of minus 0.15. Use the same angle as the velocity, and then add the two. There are probably even other possibilities, but I think I'll go with subtracting. So, we'll say friction set angle p velocity get angle to set the friction's direction, and p velocity subtract from friction to subtract friction from the velocity, slowing down the object. Now we can test that, and we see that the particle shoots off and slows down and stops as friction reduces its velocity. But it's not quite right. You may not be able to see it here, but the particle is still moving slightly. That's because we forgot to check when the particle's velocity reached zero. Once it does, we shouldn't be applying that friction vector anymore. In fact, once the velocity's magnitude is less than friction's, we should just set velocity to zero. Otherwise, we run the risk of having friction reverse the particle's direction, which should never happen. So, first we check if p velocity get length is greater than friction get length. If so, we do the subtraction. If not, we set p velocity's length to zero. Now we test that, and we have a fairly accurate, if greatly simplified, friction. Cool. But let's look what's happening in this code. First, this line here. We have a get angle and a set angle. If we look at the vector object definition for those methods, we see three calls to trig functions. Also, set angle has a call to get length, which calls math square root. Then, back in the loop, we have two more calls to get length, which equals two more calls to math square root. Then we either call subtract from, which isn't too bad, but contains two other function calls to get x and get y, or we call set length, which calls get angle, which calls math a tan 2, then math cosine and math sine, so three more trig calls. All this means up to six trig calls and three square root calls per object per frame just for friction. Yikes. Now, as I've been promising, we'll eventually get around to cleaning up the particle class. But still, most of those calculations are going to be needed. You need to compare lengths, which is square roots, and you need to calculate angles, which is trig. But there is an alternate way. It's not exactly accurate, but let's try it out and see how it looks. In this alternate strategy, rather than adding a reverse vector to the velocity for friction, we reduce the velocity by a percentage. Again, we choose an arbitrary number using trial and error until things look right. Let's say 0.9 for simplicity. Particle's velocity's magnitude starts at 10. We multiply that times 0.9, and we get 9 pixels per frame. On the next frame, we multiply that times 0.9, and we get 8.1. Next frame, 7.29, then 6.561, and so on. Eventually, the numbers will get very small, and velocity will be effectively zero. Now, the pros of this method are, 1, it uses simple multiplication. No trig, no square roots. Friction, in this case, doesn't need to have a direction, so there's no getting or setting of angles. 3, There's no need to check if velocity is less than friction or if velocity is zero. But the cons of this method are, well, there's only really one con. It's not real friction. So it looks different. But let's code it up and see if it's acceptable to you. Going back to our original particle code, this time in friction2.js, I create a simple friction variable and set it to 0.97. Again, trial and error. In the update function, I simply say p velocity multiplied by friction. Next, wait, there is no next. That's all we need to do. And realize that in vector multiply by, all we're doing is two simple multiplication operations. Not even any other method calls. Super simple, super fast. Let's see how it looks. So you might notice that it is inherently different. The particle takes a bit longer to slow down. That's because the slower it's going, the less friction there is. But I'm pretty sure the only reason you really notice this is because you just saw the first version. If I just showed you this version and said, this is friction, you'd most likely accept it without question. So for me, this is totally adequate, and acceptable enough that I'm going to add it right into the particle object. I'll go into particle.js and add a friction property, default it to 1. This essentially means no friction. You're multiplying velocity by 1 on each frame, so it doesn't change. Now on particle update, I'm simply going to say this velocity multiply by this friction. Done. To see this in action in a real-life example, I'm going to bring back the asteroid ship from episode 10. This is the exact code we ended up with at the end of that episode with the file ship2.js, but I'm going to use it with this new updated particle.js file. And I'm going to add in one line here saying ship.friction equals 0.99. Yep, trial and error. So we test that, and we find we have a very different type of ship. Instead of just zooming around endlessly, it slows down and stops when you're not applying any thrust. Of course, technically speaking, this is completely unrealistic as there's virtually no friction in space. But this might be just the type of physics you want in your game. It's all about creating the kind of effect you want to create. Now you might notice in general that the ship moves a bit slower and seems a bit sluggish. Remember that friction is applied on every frame, so it's effectively reducing the amount of thrust that's being applied. To account for this, you can just up the amount of thrust you're applying. Okay, that's all for friction. Join me next week for, well, I don't know yet, but it'll be something cool, I'm sure.